Right here I have a camera that's been modified so that it shoots in infrared. Now the only thing that's different about it is that its IR blocking filter was replaced with one that only lets IR light through. Now for such a simple modification, the effect is actually really crazy. This is what I look like on an IR camera. My skin is pastier than normal, the patterns of my shirt disappeared, and my eyes are black and look slightly possessed. Now what else can I do with the camera? Well, for one, anything with an IR transmitter in it, like this TV remote here, is going to look really bright on the camera, even though it's actually invisible to our eyes. Infrared light can shoot through a lot of materials that we normally consider opaque. For example, here I have a glass of Coke. Now to our eyes it looks dark because it doesn't let much visible light through. But on the IR camera you can see right through it, and that's because it's basically transparent to shortwave IR. Pretty cool, right? Now you guys know how it goes on this channel. I'm not just going to sit around and give you fluff about infrared photography. The only way I can have fun with this thing is if I build some giant IR lasers. A surprisingly simple way to make a powerful IR laser is actually by just tearing down a green laser pointer. Now the reason being is that most green laser pointers don't actually have a green laser diode inside. Instead it uses an infrared laser that pumps a set of crystals to make green light. Now lucky for us, this process is not very efficient, so there has to be a powerful IR laser inside for this to work. Now before I start tearing this thing apart, I should point out that the experiments that were done in this video were done completely for educational purposes. And in fact, if you were to try any of this stuff at home, you'd almost certainly get killed or at least permanently maimed. So yeah, please don't try this at home. Green laser pointers have a lot of fragile components inside, so it's important that they're handled with care. Now actually disassembling this thing turned out to be really difficult, as everything was either glued or permanently pressed into place. I know honestly it's hard not to use swear words to describe the process of taking it apart. Anyways, at the expense of the laser pointer casing, I was able to remove the laser module. Now the orthovandate and KTP crystals used to generate green light sit right on top of that IR laser diode, so removing these exposes the raw IR output. On my normal camera, this output shows up as a very dim pink. Now if I was dumb enough to look at it with my own eyes, I'd actually see a faint red glow. But with the IR camera, it's obvious that it's actually very powerful. It lights up my entire desk with IR light. But in order to do anything fun with it, I need to focus the output with a lens. Instead of trying to painstakingly mount a tiny lens over the laser diode at just the right distance, I found it easier to just remove the laser diode and stick in a module with an adjustable threaded lens mount. The finished product is actually really scary. Not only is it invisible, but can still blind in a fraction of a second, and that's why I wear laser goggles when I'm working with it. Now to those of my viewers out there who are interested in experimenting around with lasers, a powerful IR laser should not be your first project. The focused laser looks really cool on the IR camera. And plus with the adjustable lens mount, I can focus the beam to a tiny spot so it can burn things. A match lights instantly when it's placed inside the focal point of the beam. And now I can also cut through thin dark plastic with ease. Alright, I gotta do it. I gotta stick my hand in the beam to see what happens, because what could possibly go wrong? Oh, wow, I don't feel a thing. Now, I figured it wouldn't be bad, but I was hoping it would hurt at least just a little bit. Even at the focal point, I don't feel the tiniest bit of warmth. I guess my flesh is just super transparent to the shortwave IR wavelength. Now notice that when the beam is going through my hand, it actually lights up all of my veins so they are clearly visible. That is so amazing! Alright, now I'm bored. Now it's not like this thing isn't powerful, I mean, it definitely is. I mean, come on, it doesn't even reach the class 4 danger rating. I feel like I need something that's at least 100 times stronger. And now unfortunately, a giant portable IR death ray isn't just something I can go and buy online. So I guess this means I have to build one myself. Now one of the fun parts about designing a laser like this is that I'm completely at the mercy of what parts I can find cheaply on eBay. Now lucky for me, high-tech startups are constantly failing, and militaries around the world are always getting rid of old laser hardware. That means there's always going to be a constant supply of weapons-grade laser parts in the surplus market. I had my heart set on using a monster fiber-coupled IR laser array on the build, but buying one of these things new costs more than a brand new car. But with a little bit of luck, I was able to score this used but working 25-watt unit. For the housing, I just started with this heatsink, and just kind of went at it with a hacksaw, drill, and Dremel. And like most things in my life, I didn't actually plan anything out before diving right in, and just started cutting things and bolting stuff into place until it seemed somewhat acceptable. I ended up using a pipe for the handle, and then wired in a switch to act as a trigger. Before bolting down the laser array, I added some Arctic Silver to increase heat transfer from the laser. Now I really should have used indium foil for this, but I won't be running this thing for very long, so this shouldn't be an issue. Coming up with an efficient driver that can feed the laser a whopping 40 amps at just 2 volts turned out to be quite the challenge. But then I saw a video by Marco Reps of him building the exact driver that I needed.
Next power supply is a constant current source for the laser module. I got it from someone who has a few other powerful laser sources, and he wants me to design and assemble two universal constant current drivers. Here's a naive approach.
It's funny because my naive approach would have been a giant pile of linear regulators, so I'm really happy that I saw his video. And yeah, I ended up building a driver based on his design, and it'll work flawlessly, so a big thank you to him. In fact, you should all go check out his channel. He makes tons of cool videos on things like robotics and lasers, and I'll be sure to put a link in the description of this video. On the optic side of things, I needed something to tame the rapidly diverging beam from the fiber. I ended up using some nice few silica lenses from Esco Optics. Now these things are rated to handle the high power laser beam without exploding. I stuck the lenses in an adjustable telescope mount that I made from PVC pipe. And here is the terrifying finished product. I added a thermometer here so I can keep an eye on the laser diode's temp. I also added some indicator LEDs, one that lights up when the laser's armed, and the other one when the laser's firing. Anyway, enough with this technical junk. Let's test this thing out. Can you see me alright? Oh wait, let me turn on my giant laser. Now I built the mask that I'm wearing by fitting laser goggles into a welding helmet. I just wanted to make sure there was no chance of any stray light making it into my goggles. Now the funny thing is that I can't see this light at all, it's completely invisible to me. The only reason I know it's on is from this indicator light I stuck on it. But that being said, I'm sure it looks like I'm holding a bolt of lightning on the IR camera. That's pretty crazy to me. On my normal camera, the beam looks really weak, but obviously this isn't actually the case. Now what else can I do with this giant laser? How about triggering a 100,000 volt spark gap? Here I have a very high voltage DC power supply. When the electrodes are close enough, the spark easily jumps the gap. But when they're separated enough, the electric field is too weak for total breakdown. Instead, just a small amount of current finds its way through the cardboard. Now if I use the laser to light the matches in between the electrodes, the arc can jump the gap again. This works because the flame generates conductive ions that makes the perceived gap between the electrodes smaller. Now I'm sure there's also an avalanche effect from the extreme field grabbing charged particles and smashing them into neutral molecules in the air to make even more ions. Here's another cool trick. The plastic tubes here are filled with strontium aluminate glow powder. When I light the pile of flash powder below with the laser, it energizes the aluminate so it glows. Now when I shine the IR laser at the powder, it glows much brighter. In fact, I can actually see the laser spot through the goggles this way. This is actually how those IR visualizer cards work. Now if it weren't for the extreme blinding hazard, this thing would also function as basically the world's best night vision flashlight. This thing has the potential to light up things for miles, but that wouldn't exactly be safe or legal, so I guess I'm just gonna have to use this thing for blowing up stuff at home. Well, that's about all of the useful things this laser can do. Now let's see what this thing can destroy. Alright, so that's about it for this video. Now, I apologize for the lack of videos recently. It's just been so cold here. It's basically impossible to heat this uninsulated shop above freezing. Now, luckily, this won't be an issue much longer, as I'm about ready to move into a new shop that actually has insulation. And even better, it has a much bigger electrical connection. So stay tuned for that. And yeah, until the next time, stay safe and happy lasing.